You're tuned in to the Daily BS.
Do you believe it?
Sports and culture combined into one.
Michael on the drive across the lane. Turnaround shot. Got it. 63 for Jordan.
Are you kidding me?
He did what?
The Daily BS begins.
Bazinga.
Right now.
Right. Googly moogly.
Hadouken!
Hey, this promises to be fun.
Can't wait.
Well, good afternoon, folks. Brian Snow is here and with you, and we're ready to get down to some Daily BS business, sports and culture combined into one. You can hear a replay of this show 1 hour after its completion, and the premiere of the Daily BS podcast will also be available 1 hour after this show's completion. We are on all kinds of networks and stations all across the country. Well, let me use my normal phrase, in the region, across the nation, and around the world. So if you're in your car on the drive home and you got me via your phone, via your laptop, via whatever, welcome to the Daily BS, and let old Brian take you home with some great sports and culture talk. All right, enough introductions. Let's get started. I got to tell you something, folks, with the draft coming up, even though it's going to be virtual, it's still the NFL draft. I don't know which way the 49ers are going to lean. I mean, I have my thoughts, but I'm going to have to get some help on this one. And to help me is Mike DeBate, my NFL analyst that comes on each week. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing great, Brian. Always a pleasure to join you. Hope you're staying safe. Hope you're staying well. Always a pleasure to be able to talk some ball with you under any circumstances, especially the ones in which we live right now.
Absolutely. Let's dive in. I've got two names on my list right now. And the 49ers could wind up getting both these guys. One we spoke of, Javon Kinlaw out of South Carolina. And then this name popped on my radar, Denzel Mims from Baylor.
I think both of those choices are actually very, very good, and I think a lot of what you're seeing from the 49ers supports that they would be able to do that. Listen, they're definitely going to go the pass rushing route, and I think that that's something that they will address. Now, will they address it early on in the draft? That's still up for debate. They have the number 13 pick. They acquired it for a reason. The loss of Buckner is definitely something that allows me to believe that they would go in this direction. And look, Kinlaw is one of the best in the draft right now. You want to talk about versatility. He's very good off the block. He's able to play in multiple defensive sets, whether it be 3-4, 4-3. I really, really like his ability to come after the passer, especially in the NFC, which is going to have its share of prolific passers this year. Mm-hmm. They're going to need to do that, and I definitely like what he brings to the table. Mentioning Mims, actually, I discussed Mims on Locked On Patriots on Friday with a good friend of mine, Evan Lazar of CLNS Media, as a possibility for the New England Patriots, possibly if they decide to throw their hat in the ring and trade up into the second round. Mims, I think, has first-round potential. I think he may end up going in the second. And the reason why I say that is because I believe that because the wide receiver market is so diverse and so deep this year, it may force a guy like Mims to be taken a little bit later than he normally should. But again, I really like the productivity here. I like his versatility and his ability to pair with a guy like Jimmy Garoppolo, who I think would be a great battery mate for him. So I'm intrigued by those picks, and I think you're onto something there with both of them.
Yeah, they may wind up snatching both of them. And on top of that, they have a fellow waiting in the bullpen by the name of Jalen Hurd, also out of Baylor. His back injury kept him out last year. We saw what Deebo Samuel is able to do, and he's going to be counted on a lot. Jalen Hurd may be counted on a lot also, but to have that third wide receiver in Denzel Mims, and then you put Kendrick Bourne and then the best tight end in the game in George Kittle, this 49er offense, which depends a lot on the run, as dangerous as it was with a selection of a wide receiver, and there are a lot of them available, they could be even more dangerous.
They could be. They absolutely could be. And the one thing about the 49ers that I would caution fans not to scoff at or to get upset or angry with, they may choose to go that route with the number 13 pick. I mean, if you take a look at some of the needs of the teams ahead of them, it's very possible that a guy like Jerry Jeudy or a guy that I chronicled for the New England Patriots just a couple of days ago, as a real long shot, they would have to trade up to get him. But a guy like Henry Ruggs III,
mm-hmm.
I mean, you look at some of the talent that is in this draft this year. When it comes to the wide receiver position that I alluded to earlier, 49ers with that type of speed that Ruggs brings to the table, especially, it'd be amazing, and it'd be an unbelievable compliment to what's already a very formidable running game. If you have a guy that's able to take the top off the defense like a Ruggs, I just don't see anybody being able to match him speed for speed with corners in the league. And you're talking about some of the better corners and the better defenses that you have in the NFC. So I think he'll be able to be a burner in this league. If he's there at number 13, hard for me to imagine that the Niners would pass on him. And obviously Jeudy, to me, I think Jeudy is even a better fit in San Francisco because of his hands, because of his technique, his route running ability. To me, I think there's so much that I like about these two wide receivers that if the 49ers are faced with an option of choosing either one of these guys at number 13, I think it's going to be very hard for them to pass them up. So I tend to agree with what you're saying about them going defensively in the route with the first pick that they have. But if they have the chance to snag one of these types of generational talents, I think it's going to be so tough for them to turn it down.
Yeah, I truly believe that also with the receivers that are available in this draft. Which way do the Patriots lean?
Well, right now, that's the million-dollar question up here in New England. I mean, with the departure of Tom Brady, do the Patriots decide to toss their hat into the ring, make a move for their quarterback of the future? Now, from the people that I spoke to within the organization, and we've talked about this, Brian, Jarrett Stidham seems to be the consensus guy under center this year. I think Bill Belichick, Josh McDaniels, have seen what this kid can do in practice, much more so than any of either the beat writers or whatnot. I've had the opportunity to see him a little bit in practice. Jarrett looks very good, but they seem to know something about this kid that maybe we don't. Look, if they go the quarterback route, there's a lot of names out there. If they decide to pull the trigger at number 23, Jordan Love is the hot name right now. Jordan is a quarterback that I think can be very prolific in this league. The problem is with the Patriots' flux of the offensive line right now, especially with the retirement of Dante Scarnecchia, I think it's going to be interesting to see with a guy that has a little difficulty making throws under pressure, if he's necessarily going to be the guy that they want taking snaps under center at number 23 this year. So I think they may look toward the third round for an option there. If that's the case, James Morgan out of FIU is a possibility. They've mentioned also Anthony Gordon as a possibility as well. But the guy I really like for the Patriots, if they're going to go the quarterback route and try to add some depth, is Jake Fromm out of Georgia. I know he doesn't have the cannon for an arm that a lot of people believe he should, but his decision-making and his football IQ, to me, make him a very good fit in New England. And I think he's the type of quarterback that Josh McDaniels and Bill Belichick love. He's not going to win you games with his arm, but he's going to win you games with his football IQ, his acumen, and his ability to protect the football. He very, very seldom turns it over. There are a lot of different options. It's not just quarterback. Honestly, my gut tells me that the Patriots go offensive line in the first round, and I know that's going to raise a lot of eyebrows, but the guy that I really like for the New England Patriots this year is offensive lineman Cesar Ruiz out of University of Michigan. To me, he's the type of versatile offensive lineman that can play center, he can play the interior, he can even kick out and play tackle if he needs to. With the Patriots question marks, you don't know if they're going to trade Joe Tooney after he blew up his franchise. You don't know if David Andrews is going to be able to be back after suffering blood clots in his lungs. These are all types of issues that the Patriots are faced with. I believe they go this route, and Ruiz is that type of versatile offensive lineman that can really solidify the line. If they choose to go defense, I think they go linebacker or edge rush. Obviously, Patrick Queen is the hot name out there right now. Tons of talent, unbelievable motor, a little undersized in terms of the type of linebackers that Bill Belichick likes to employ. I think Kenneth Murray out of Oklahoma is an option as well. I like the way he matches up in this defense. And A.J. Epineza out of Iowa is another name that I have on my radar for the Pats. So they could go all over the board in a number of different directions, but my three you know, areas of need that they would look to target early are probably offensive line, defense, and then quarterback in that order.
How would the Chicago Bears attack the draft this year? Which way do they really need to lean to be competitive this year?
Honestly, I think they have a number of different options. I really like, obviously, the addition of Robert Quinn to go along with Khalil Mack. So I would have said defense, even though that tends to be the strength of what they have. But at this point, you have to wonder whether or not they might be looking at that defense and saying, you know what, if they have an opportunity to maybe go in secondary a little bit, that could be an option. I think wide receiver is a good market for them right now. I think there's a lot of different receivers that could work very well in their system, guys that are capable of playing in the slot. T. Higgins, believe it or not, I think would be a very good option there. K.J. Hamler is a guy that I would look at out of Penn State. Tremendous route runner, good in the slot, can play a little on the outside. I think he would fit nicely into that offense. But ultimately, it's going to be about who is going to get the keys to drive the car this year in Chicago. They brought in Nick Foles. You have to think that he's going to be at least competing for the starting job against Mitch Trubisky. I still don't think that Trubisky's career is dead and buried in Chicago. I still believe that there's something there to bite on. So it's going to be interesting to see what the Bears do and how they do it, how they're able to bring it in. But right now, I say if they go defensive, I think they try to enrich the secondary a little bit, either a safety or a cornerback. If they go the offensive route, I think they try to go wide receiver and get some pop at the offensive skill position.
Let's go back to San Francisco. Is there secondary help available in the draft for them? Because ultimately, it was the secondary that cost them the Super Bowl. A lot of pundits like to think that. So let's just play devil's advocate. Is there secondary help available in this draft for San Francisco for them to keep their NFC title?
I think so, and I think that if they do, I like some of the options at safety. Antoine Winfield Jr., I think, would be a nice addition in that backfield to be able to provide the type of intelligence and the type of versatility at that position that I think could really help the San Francisco 49ers. Another guy that I don't know if he'd be there. I don't know if maybe they would need to make a trade or maneuver around. But I like Xavier McKinney's fit and his ability as well. McKinney is one of those types of very versatile defensive backs that is listed as a safety. But believe it or not, there were times where he did line up at cornerback a little bit during his collegiate career. You have to wonder if that type of versatility would do him well in San Francisco. So I do think there are options. I would go with more of the versatile route rather than the traditional corner. I think right now, I think the cornerback play that they got in San Francisco last year, I think was much maligned for a terrible reason. I think Richard Sherman has a lot left in the tank, and I think he can be a very good mentor to some of these young guys coming up. Obviously, the big, you know, cornerback name out there is C.J. Henderson. I'm not sure if he would be available to the Niners unless they really wanted to make a bold statement and go in that direction early on in the draft. I think there's other pressing needs on the team, to be honest with you, Brian, but those are the guys that I would look at right now. I've got my eye on a couple of those, different versatile safeties that could make an impact there. Grant Delpit is another name that I would keep an eye on if I'm the San Francisco 49ers, if they choose to maybe give away that 13th pick and then trade down a little bit in the first round to a team that might want to trade up. That could be an option as well, but I don't believe they're doing that. I think to get rid of a guy like Buckner, they acquired that 13th pick for a reason, and I expect them to use it, and I think they've already targeted and probably locked into exactly who they'd like to have.
Yeah, I'm thinking it's going to be Javon Kinlaw out of South Carolina because he fits that defense perfectly no matter where they line him up, no matter what scheme they line him up, 3-4 or 4-3, he could easily slip into that spot that was vacated by them trading Buckner to Indianapolis.
Absolutely, and again, Kinlaw is one of the top, versatile defensive edge rush linebackers, pseudo, that type of role that could really bring a lot of pop and a lot of help and immediately fill a void that they left behind when they needed to trade Buckner. So to me, I think that you're putting me on the spot right now, and I'm not saying that you are, my friend, but if you are, I would say Kinlaw is the guy that I believe they will take. We were able to pinpoint last year Nick Bosa, obviously with the number two pick, a little bit easier to zero in. But yeah. To me, Kinlaw just makes so much sense on so many levels for the 49ers. I don't see them going in a different direction this time around.
I don't see them going in a different direction either. It was the defense that helped get them back on top. And, you know, John Lynch and his brain trust, they're going to lean that way again. And I will say this again, and you've agreed with me this entire time. Until someone goes to Levi's Stadium in the NFC and unseats them, the 49ers are the team to beat in the NFC.
Absolutely, and I don't think anything has changed. Look, I know the Saints have loaded up a little bit. Getting Emmanuel Sanders, being able to take him away from San Francisco was kind of a moral victory, I guess, for New Orleans. Obviously, Tampa Bay has much improved. You know, adding one of the greatest, you know, quarterbacks still in the league,
yes,
arguably the greatest of all time in Tom Brady. They're definitely going to be a formidable force this year. Seattle, to me, is a team that is quietly having a very nice offseason,
mm-hmm,
and they're doing it in a way that I think is going to, I don't want to say surprise people. I mean, this was a very formidable playoff team last year, so they're not going to speak up on anybody. But I think Seattle is going to be a lot better than people are giving them credit right now. I know New Orleans and Tampa Bay are now the teams with the shiny new toys, but to me, I'm going with a team that had a lot of stability last year and quietly made those additions that makes you better. But ultimately, I still don't look at a roster from top to bottom in the NFC and see anybody that has overtaken or will lead me to believe that the San Francisco 49ers are not still the class of the NFC. They're still the champs, and I expect they will be at the end of the season unless something drastic happens, because I just think their roster, top to bottom, is still better than any of the other rosters that are out there right now.
And one final point before I go to a break here. Nate Burleson said this on a Good Morning Football right after they won the NFC Championship, and this still holds true for the 49ers. A lot of teams this past season have tried to rush with just four rushers. They tried to get a pass rush with just four players. The difference between all the teams that tried that and the 49ers got home, and they got home fast.
They did, and they will continue to do that. And again, if you add somebody with the pedigree of a guy like Javon Kinlaw into that defense, it allows the defense to be there. If you add someone with the explosiveness of a Henry Ruggs or a Jerry Jeudy on the offensive side of the ball early on, that allows the offense to be able to get there. This is a team that can get there and get there fast on both sides of the ball. The defense definitely gets the lion's share of the credit, and it should, but don't sleep on the offense. This is a very diverse, very complete offense, and I really like the way they're going to be able to do things this year. And I expect a pretty big year out of Jimmy G as well. So for all the stuff that he took for his play in the Super Bowl, look for this kid to bounce back. He's got ice water in his veins, and I think he proves it this year.
I really think he proves it also. And I think, and I'm going to go ahead and predict, especially with Jimmy Garoppolo and the way they're shaping things up for him offensively, there is a record in San Francisco offensively that could fall. I want y'all to think back to 1992. I'll explain that later on in the week. Mike DeBate joining me to talk all things NFL. We're counting you down to the NFL draft. We'll see who goes where. Thanks a lot, my friend. Appreciate it.
Anytime, my friend. Stay safe, stay well. Always a pleasure coming on. You take care, and thank you for your hospitality. Always my honor.
Got more stuff for you, folks. Stick around.
tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
This is the XFL. Or was the XFL. Some reports have come across my desk that the XFL is no more. Over the course of the weekend, I learned that the XFL has suspended operations and there's no plan for 2021. A lot of people were laid off, except the main executives. And all I can think is, here we go again. When the XFL premiered in 2001, it was gimmicky, it was flashy, and the football was terrible. The championship game, I don't want to even talk about. And after 1 year, everybody pulled the plug. The broadcast networks, the man in charge, Vince McMahon himself. Now we speed up to 2020, and the XFL comes back, and I'm thinking, here we go again. But then, something weird happened. The games were good. They changed a couple of the rules, especially with the kickoff. No one touches each other until the receiver has the ball. I kind of like that. And then you can choose whether to go for 1 point from the 2 yard line, 2 points from the 5 yard line, or 3 points from the 10-yard line, which could really bring a team back into the game. So instead of getting 8 to tie it, you can actually potentially get 9 to get the lead. And another weird thing, the games were actually good. The games were actually intriguing. You never know who was going to step up and be the leader for that particular game and that particular team. And after I saw the DC team play the Defenders, I thought, hey, I can follow this team. But then the Houston Roughnecks were the only undefeated team remaining at the time that the XFL suspended operations and canceled the rest of this season. And then the St. Louis Battlehawks had, dare I say, a full house every time they were home. But then the coronavirus happened. And for safety purposes, and I'm not downplaying it at all, I'm really not. For safety purposes, the league canceled the rest of the season. It just leaves a lot of unanswered questions for me. Would the Roughnecks been the only team to run the table? Would the Roughnecks and the Battlehawks from St. Louis meet in a championship game? Who would be the opponent for Houston? That's just one of the questions. One of the other questions is that I had was how many players would actually succeed in their mission of getting to the NFL? And the answer is plenty of them. And it started with PJ Walker, which puts a fear if you're a fan of the XFL, which I became. And the fear is this, is it going to start an exodus? And would you have to draft teams all over again? We won't know. We won't know because as of right now, the XFL is no more. And there is a strong, strong chance that the XFL would permanently be no more, which means no reboot. And I liked this particular reboot. As I said, the games were good. They were fun to watch. ESPN got involved and put their money where their mouth was. And the production was great. You can stop all the sideline interviews, you know, and let the guys play football and then catch them at halftime. Yeah, you could slow that up. But at the same time, the XFL brought the stadium camera, the flyby camera, into today's NFL. So there were a few, there were some things to like about this rebooted version of the XFL. But what makes me angry as a fan is that it's taken away before it can realize, before the full potential can be realized. Same with the Alliance of American Football. But that was just a crap show from the beginning, especially when investors are pulling out. The games were okay. The players were hungry. You had football in San Diego, which I still believe should be home of the San Diego Chargers, but that's a discussion for another day. And now you're left with something to the tune of, now what? Can the XFL come back a third time? Can they? It won't be a problem due to money. It will not be a problem due to money. I can guarantee you that. But how can the XFL come back a third time? And another question that someone brought to me, and I really think it should be asked, can the XFL and the Alliance of American Football merge their teams? Can that be done? Make it a 16-team league? Well, I don't know if that can be done, because it's going to involve a lot of talking. It's going to involve a lot of structure, which the Alliance of American Football did not have. They just didn't have it. It's going to involve people that actually know football to take the AAF over and merge it. It's going to be at least a two-year process. At least a two-year process. But put the time into it and look at it, at the very least. As far as the XFL goes, the exodus, as far as the players, have begun, and it began with P.J. Walker from Houston. It began with P.J. Walker, and P.J. Walker was just plain showing off with the Roughnecks. Again, the question I take away from this, finding out that the XFL has suspended operations and there's no clue on 2021, the question I pose is, now what? What's going to happen to the players? What's going to happen to the folks that were working in the stadiums? What's going to happen to the folks that were broadcasting the games? What's going to happen to the radio broadcasters? ESPN's going to be fine. You know, as far as I'm concerned, they took it on as a project and they added their production expertise. And they're good when it comes to live events. Let me say that. As much disdain as I have for that four-letter network, when it comes to live events, they know how to put a show together. Okay? In most cases, I'll add that. In most cases, they know how to put a show together. I don't know if I can just pick one thing that concerns me the most. The players, the workers, the broadcasters, the fans. How about the fans? The ratings were starting to dwindle each week, but the football got stronger. The football got stronger. And yeah, we saw our first double forward pass executed in the XFL. I think they had the wrong face of the XFL because everybody was depending on Cardale Jones to show them something, and he kept regressing. Meanwhile, P.J. Walker was leading an undefeated Roughnecks team, I nearly said Rockets, an undefeated Roughnecks team, possibly to a championship. It's weird. It's going to be weird for a while without spring football, without football, period. It's been that way since the sports have shut down due to the coronavirus. And I'll throw this in there. I hope everyone is safe and staying home when you're told to stay home, and just keeping yourselves healthy. I mean that from the heart. But as a sportsman, I'm kind of lonely. I mean, I got enough Michael Jordan stuff to, you know, keep me busy. But I'll discuss that later on in the show. But what do you do? If you're a fan of the XFL, what do you do? You can't complain because it was a pandemic that shut everything down. You really can't complain because people's lives can potentially be in jeopardy, health-wise especially. What do you do? I guess we all got to do what we have been doing since March 16th, and that's sit back and wait. You kind of had the feeling with the other league shutting down that the XFL would bite the dust. I was just hoping it wouldn't bite the dust. I just hope it wouldn't have bitten the dust, period. That's the way I wanted to say it. I just wish they would have kept this season canceled and found a way to come back in 2021. I still hold out hope for that. I still hold out hope for that. But we'll have to see. Meanwhile, we enter another day without sports. So, to the XFL, we hardly knew you. Pause for a timeout. Got more stuff for you. Back in a flash.
You're tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
We are rolling right along here on the program. Thank y'all for joining us. So I'm going to go off the board a little bit. I had a very wonderful guest and her daughter join me for a team interview. And I said, well, when can I get you back on the show? And she says, I'm ready anytime you want. Who do you want to join me this time? So, of course, me being who I am, I said, bring your husband. Let's really get down to some business. Shirley Walker King and her husband Vince are now here. How are you guys?
Hello,
sir. How are you doing?
I'm doing absolutely fabulous. It's great to have you guys on, and I'll tell you what, you guys talking marriage in a podcast, sign me up, please.
We can do that.
that's the least we can do. I mean, we haven't stayed married this long not to be able to talk about it.
So true. So many of my friends followed when I got married last June, and it's been, I got to be honest, part of it's been a struggle because we're just getting used to North Carolina. But outside of that, I can't do anything without my Dr. K next to me. I mean, it's a team effort. It truly is.
That's right. And that's what I always tell folks. I mean, it's like a business. You know what I mean? Being in the marriage is a business. So you always have to consult with your partner pretty much on things that you do, you know. And sometimes, you know, we got married a lot at a young age. So, you know, at that time it was guys making fun of you. You know, being 22, 23 years old, of course, Vincent can't do this, can't do that.
Right.
But I always kind of consulted with my wife with things. So I, you know, kind of didn't care about that. But, and not to just say everything was smooth. Of course, we had our ups and downs, but I kind of got it after a minute of a couple bumps upside the head. I got it.
Nothing that left a permanent mark. He's okay, folks. He's okay. Okay.
Figuratively speaking, okay?
I understand.
And I think there's a statute of limitation. He can't press charges now anyway.
Because A, y'all have been married too long, and B, there are kids that are turn up as witnesses and say, look, he did this and I can prove it. And I mean this jokingly, of course, being not only a husband but also a parent, but your kids will look at you and look at the husband and say, yep, he did it. And running joke that my wife and I do all the time, and you got to have humor in a marriage. You absolutely have to. So one of the running jokes that my wife and I do, and we do it all the time, if something happens where, like, she, like, drops something or something accidentally breaks, she'll just walk by me and said, you know it's your fault, right? And that's been our running joke for the 2 years we've been together.
Yeah, that's just something us men have to deal with, okay? That I get that, too. It's my fault. And, you know, my daughter and wife will look at each other and, like, shrug their shoulders, like, what? Yeah, it's your fault. Okay.
You know, we have that thing that we women can always go to default on and say, hey, you're the man of the house. It's your fault.
and it's so true. Like I said, my wife teases me all the time with it, and you know, something will happen in the house. I could be, and Vince, I know you've gone through this, I could be on the other side of the house doing something completely different, and you know, my Dr. K just walk by me and she'll show me, you know, something she dropped, and she just goes, you know, this is your fault, right? And my brain's thinking, how? I'm on the other side of the house. Now I just look at her and go, I didn't do this one. She says, yes, you did, and I can prove it. I said, all right, prove it. And then she'll go, I don't have to prove it. And we'll both just start laughing.
Hey, like you said, you have to keep the humor.
You have to.
You definitely have to laugh, especially in these times. So, you know, we just find any little thing and we can kind of laugh at it and, just, and you know.
She's also my producer. She just yelled in my ear. She goes, I'm always right and you're always wrong. And I'm sitting here laughing about it because again, and it brings up a very important point that we talk about all the time. You have to keep the humor in the relationship. You absolutely have to, because if you don't, the relationship will erode very quickly.
Yeah, definitely. And one of the things I think that people struggle with the most when they go into a relationship is at the beginning, is because you're two separate individual people.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to learn how to merge your relationship into one. Mm-hmm. And as an individual, we always want to be what? We always want to be right.
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 No matter what, you want to be the one who's the last woman or man standing. You want to be the one who was right. You want to be the one who knew the most. Mm-hmm. And in a relationship, and this goes more for the women than the men, sometimes I have to tell them, you have to decide, do you want to be right or do you want to be happy?
Yeah. Yeah, and I decided.
Pick your battles.
Yeah, I decided I want to be happy. And after I met my Dr. K, I have been truly happy for the 2 years we've been together and the almost year that we've been married. And it's not just about sense of humor; it's about a very simple slash complex slash most important thing in a relationship. A little word we like to call communication.
That's it. Communication, that's key.
It is key because she and I talk about everything, and people think I exaggerate when I say this. I'm not exaggerating. We talk and discuss everything. We talk everything out, and you have to talk everything out with your partner, because if you can't talk everything out with your partner, then who the hell are you going to talk it out to? It just doesn't fit.
Gotcha.
Oh, yeah, that works. Like, if you can't say that your partner is your best friend, and in the sense of not if that's the person that you're going to go get your hands and nails and everything done with, but if you can't say your partner is the best friend, then your relationship is not at a point where it should have been a marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
That is so true, because if you can't talk everything out, then there's your first problem. I've had people ask me all the time, you know, how can you guys, even for the short time that you guys have been together, how can you guys smile most of the time? I said, I talk to her about everything. And I trust her enough, and vice versa. And she trusts me enough to, you know, lean on each other. The biggest thing is, with the communication, you also lean on each other. Good times, bad times, whatever time it is. When you have that, you have a very solid foundation.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. And like I said, you know, you know your partner, you kind of get a vibe from them. If something's, they don't even have to say it, you just know something's not right. You know what I mean? So, I think that's a big thing. I can just tell, when something's bothering her, and, you know, sometimes she'll need a minute to, you know, for whatever it might be, but I just know. I mean, we'll kind of hash it out, and she'll let me in on what's going on. But you just know your partner.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah, that's it. You just know your partner.
It's so true. When they need to talk to you, and something that I have been taught by my wife, she says it all the time. She says, sometimes I don't need you to fix anything. Sometimes I just need you to listen. And that was one of the most important things I had to learn with her. That's one of the most important things that I had to learn, because as men in this society, we're taught – and where it's ingrained in us, okay, something's wrong with your partner, you have to fix it. No, sometimes they just need to get some stuff off their chest, and you just need to listen. That's a part I'm still learning, and I've gotten better at it. Will I ever be perfect at it? No, and I don't want to be. But when I get the clue and I see the look on in her eyes, okay, I'm just going to shut up, and I'm going to let her talk.
Yeah, we did a post, when was that, Wednesday last week?
Yeah.
And that's our number 10 was listen more and talk less.
Yes.
And that's exactly what we talked about. Sometimes your partner don't want you to say a word. Just listen. They'll let you know, if they want you to chime in, but just be quiet and listen.
Was it tough when you guys got together at such a young age to – like really, really trust each other with decisions? I mean, how tough was it for you guys to trust each other with decisions and start making them together?
Ooh, I'm gonna.
I wouldn't say it was tough for me, coming from a two-parent household. For me, it wasn't tough because I saw how my mother handled her marriages, and I'll put jizz because she's been married more than once, twice, three times, four times, I think five.
Mm-hmm. Like Elizabeth Taylor. Elizabeth Taylor-ish.
Shirley Ann Jackson Coleman, Locke Johnson Sherwood knows how to get married. y'all not gonna talk about my mother. But the one thing that my mother did instill in me was marriage was important. And yes, she was a strong, independent woman, but she also showed me that a strong, independent woman also needs a man to support her and be with her mm-hmm. at all times. She needs that. That's what God intended this world and this relationship how to work.
Absolutely.
So man needs woman, woman needs man. So I did learn that from my mother, and I also learned how to share in decision making with my spouse because of how I saw my mother operate.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a challenge in the beginning because you are so independent. When I met my husband, we met in California, technically Tijuana partying, but that's a whole nother story. So we'll just skip the over the border part. We'll just talk about stateside part for now. So we met, like you said, young. I was already independent and had been living on my own since I was 18 because my mother left California, moved back to Texas the month I graduated high school. So I was living on my own. I worked for a prison system. So I knew what I wanted, how I wanted, what I wanted to do. And I knew what I didn't want. So when I finally met Vince, and I think I had been in a couple of relationships where I was like, look, I have to be able to let my guard down, and I'm still working on that, but to be able to trust somebody and let them, allow them to help lead my direction. And for Vincent being in the military, and Vincent is an only child born and raised in Cleveland, Ohio, raised by a strong, independent woman who didn't play yet either, I think he was able to learn how to work around my rough edges and not do that I am man beat on my chest thing, like, woman, listen to me. I think he knew early on that that wasn't going to be the way that he was going to get to my heart or allow me to let down my walls. So as we start, you know, dated a little longer and, you know, we found out we were going to be expecting a baby and I didn't have the flu. Because I tell you, Corona was around in 1992. So he has to tell you guys. I had all the symptoms.
Hey, being from Chicago, there is truth to every part of that sentence.
Right.
That's correct.
So, yeah, it was, I think, a little easier for me, and maybe, and I'll let Vincent speak on that, because he was an only child. I think once he realized he had someone else depending on him making the best decision, I think that's where he had to kind of pull in from his lifestyle and upbringing. How do we do this, and how do we do this together?
Yeah. And like I said, us being young, military, so kind of, and we talk about this and laugh about it now. She would always say, like, her strategy was, you know, and we would go on deployments, you know, we would have to literally leave for 6 months. And then we came back stateside, you know, of course, all the fellas want to hang out. So what she would always do was, okay, everybody come over here. They'll always know the king's house. So we would always cook out. So I wouldn't really want to go out and hang out with the guys. So I can just bring everybody over. We cook out, and just everybody knew the kings, you know, they can come and get fed well. So that was like her little strategy, that she kind of put me onto that later. I'm like, you know what? That was pretty good. that worked out. You know, that kept me from wanting to hang out. And, you know, at 22 years old, we just bring everybody over, you know, a lot of single people on the ships, and we would always cook and kind of like we had the place where everybody wanted to come and kind of away from home, and they got home cooked meals and things of that sort.
Shirley Walker.
But, you know, it was a little more difficult for me, like you said, adjusting, just yeah. being the only child. So, you know, it was more difficult for me to adjust, I would say.
Shirley Walker King and Vince King joining me, talking all parts of marriage, good, bad, ugly, whatever. I got so many questions in my head. And as I said, I'm just entering, I will be in June entering my second year of marriage. Y'all have been doing this a long time. I got to pose this, and this is for both of you. When did you know that Vince to Shirley, when did you know that she would be the one for you? How did you, what was the bell that went off and said, okay, she's going to be here and she's going to be around for me and she's going to support me. When did you know that she was the one?
That's for me to show. Mm-hmm. For me, oh, wow. Man, and you know, that's funny because I always told myself that I wasn't doing this. Especially when I was in the military, you know, right. Like, and that was literally my first duty station. So I didn't even make it to the second duty station. So I don't know what I was thinking. So I guess God said, I have other plans for you, sir.
Yes.
But I don't know. I guess just us hanging out and talking and, you know, we used to go out to parties and see each other and we would always just meet up and, it's just something when they say, you know,
yeah.
And I just knew if I was to leave California, it just didn't feel right. You know, I just knew it was her. it's just funny. It just seems like I just knew, you know, I just knew yeah. from just conversations. I just knew she was going to be the one that I really wanted to be with.
Shirley, same question to you. How'd you know Vince was the one?
For me, I think, and both of us were in that same boat where we both were kind of dating and young. And I always pictured myself with children, but it's ironic that I had never really pictured a husband.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't grow up thinking of the ideal wedding of, you know, planning a wedding and walking down the aisle and picking out a wedding dress. I didn't do that. And it's not that I wasn't a girly girl, because I was, you know, although I played basketball, I was the girl who went to the game dressed up. So it wasn't that, because some people try and say that, you know, if you're a tomboy, you don't really think about that stuff. But I wasn't a tomboy as much as I was just, you know, an active girl. But I didn't picture marriage for say, but for Vincent, he was different for me. And, like I said, I grew up in San Diego, California, so I had been dating since I had probably was 16, dating guys, whether my mom knew about it or not. But I think one of the first, when we met, Vincent said he saw me first. Vincent saw me before I saw him. Let me give a little background. But his friend approached me before he did. And so that whole weekend in California, if anybody's from California, they know you can party from Sunday to Sunday. They were having an event that next day, and we all went to a beach party, and, you know, his friend was still trying to talk to me and wanted to give me his jacket so that I wouldn't be cold. And I was like, no, I don't want your jacket. For one, I don't want you branding me. There's too many ouches out here. Hold on now. But Vincent and I really didn't connect until that night, I think, when we went out to a club. And so we were talking, and I just liked the way that he had a conversation with you. Mm-hmm. He actually wanted to get to know you. It wasn't just about collecting phone numbers and, you know, just trying to see whose pants he can get in. And if it was, his game wasn't obvious. I'll put it that way. And as he mentioned, he was in the military, so they had to go out to sea for 30 days, like maybe 2 weeks after we met.
Yeah.
And then Vincent actually got in trouble maybe right after you guys come back from that deployment. So this was within like the 60 days, within 90 days, I didn't see him for at least 60. But Vincent, and he didn't know where I live, but he somehow got my address. And this was before social media and internet.
Yeah.
And he sent me a card from home because he had to go home for an emergency leave for something. And that's when I was like, okay, he is definitely something different and something new. And I kind of knew he was special.
Yeah.
Didn't necessarily know he was going to be the one, but I knew he was special.
I tell you what, with me, When I met Jody, we met in July of 2018, and I was a month away from beginning my new broadcast season. And it took till week three of that season. It was a Saturday afternoon when I called her, and I heard I was in the booth doing a football game. And I said, you know what? I'm going to have a little fun. Now, folks, This is one of the few times I will share this. And guys will be inventive to a point. And I said, I've never made a first call to a young lady I was interested in while on the air. I told myself, and Vince, you identify, you keep telling yourself, guys keep telling themselves, I'm not going to do this. I looked at her number and I said, screw it. I dialed her number, opened the phone, and I put it in my headset, and then I heard her voice. I finished two play-by-play sequences, and I heard her laugh. And it's the strangest thing. When I heard her laugh, my stomach did a flip-flop because there were butterflies in it, and I said, this is it. So I went to a break, and she just said, wow, I never had a call like this. And I said, me neither, but I love your voice and I love listening to you. And we haven't stopped talking for almost 2 years.
Wow. That's awesome. That's awesome. You just knew it.
I knew it.
You got that feeling.
I absolutely knew it, especially when she started coming to games with me. And she said, I want to be in the booth with you. So week 7, I was at Portage. And it's a cliche to a lot of people, but this is true to guys like Vince and myself. You can pick your partner out of a crowd. And there was a big crowd coming to Portage. And I saw Dr. K walk in, and I said, okay, the world's right now. She's here. I can put this headset on, and I can roll through this broadcast because my pillar of support and the love of my life just walked in the house. And I was good.
Right. Well, you know what? And I'm a little slower than she is. I did just have a birthday on the 6th.
Happy belated birthday.
Thank you. And you know, actually, you know what? Excuse me. One of the main things I laugh about is, well, I think I would say, and I did say I just knew. Well, I think it was a time we went out when we were dating. And when the bill came, she paid for the plate. I said, oh, my God. Because, you know, it's just automatic. The guy pays. And, you know, when you're married, it's different. It doesn't matter, man. It's the same card. Hey,
it is.
And that was a big deal. I was like, wow, she paid, you know, for the plate.
Yeah.
So that just took it to another level.
I remember that because I remember you asking me, well, why are you paying for it? And I said, because I asked you to go out to the movies on this round. And I think it was dinner. I said, if I asked you to go out, then I should be able to pay for it. And so I still remember having that conversation. He was like, I don't think I've ever had anybody pay for a date.
Right.
And I was like, well, I don't think you've ever dated anybody like me.
I tell you what, one of the weeks where we drove from Terre Haute to Michigan City, she finds things that just make me smile. And it was October. It was toward the end of the regular season. And she said, stop by Walgreens. I want to find something for you. I said, okay. So we stopped by Walgreens. She got some snacks for me. She got me a couple bottles of water. And she knows how much water I drink, especially when I'm on the air. So she comes out with a couple bottles of water, and I reach into the bag from Walgreens, and there, I swear to God, was football candy corn. There were different kinds of candy corn in football shapes. And I said, where'd you find this? She says, I found it in Walgreens. Let's go to the ball game and see and watch Michigan City win. I said, she found this for me. Now, the little things mean the largest things to me. Now, I will tell this funny story. The first time I attempted, and I strongly stress the word attempted, to drive from Michigan City to Terre Haute, I was in Maryville. And I did a game in Maryville, and I had no water. They had nothing but caffeine in the form of Pepsi. And I said, now what right. do I said, now what do I do? If I drink more than one Pepsi, I am in serious trouble. I said, the heck with it. So, yeah, Michigan City scored 42 points, and they won the game, and I'm working off of five or six Pepsis. And she wow. picked me up, and she said, why don't you drive back to Terre Haute? Yeah, I didn't make it far. She even went, we even stopped at a store and said, do you need some sugar for the ride? Because it's about a three-hour drive. I said, yeah. So she brings out some Reese's sticks, and I still didn't make it. I don't think I made it a good 10 miles before my body said, we're done. We're shutting down, right. whether you like it or not. And she saw it. She says, come over here. You'll get some sleep, and I'll drive back to Terre Haute. And we've been sharing driving duties since. And she knows me so very well. And
yeah.
I find it wonderful that she takes care of me just as much as I take care of her. That's like one of the sweetest things. In my eyes, yeah. that's one of the sweetest things.
And that's what a relationship is about, whether you're at the point of marriage or not. But once you're into a relationship that you know is going to go somewhere, that's what you want to do. You want to take care of your partner.
Yes.
That's what makes a relationship work, is he wants what's best for me just as much as I want what's best for me, and I want what's best for him just as much as he wants what's best for him. I'll put his needs before mine, and he'll put my needs before his.
Right.
That's a marriage.
That's absolutely a marriage. She looked me in the eye and said, I want you to chase your dreams as a broadcaster. But then when she found out and figured out what she really wanted to do, which was be a health coach, be a life coach, rather. And she mm-hmm. looked at me and we talked about it. And she says, what do you think? I really want to do this. I said, dive in and go for it. So that's just natural. That's just so natural. And she said to me so many times, I've never had anybody support me like this. I said, you don't have to ask twice. If you found something you love to do, dive in head first and go for it.
And that's what makes a marriage work. You put the needs of your spouse before yours. Of course, in a healthy relationship. Don't yes. get it twisted.
Very healthy relationship.
It's
yes.
a mutual healthy relationship. You want what's best for your partner just as much and more than they do.
Exactly. And that's exactly it. I got to have these two on again, and I'd love to have you guys so we can do an episode of Snowman Unfiltered where we go longer than this, but we're coming up against the break. At Shirley Walker King and her husband Vince King talking all things marriage. And folks, this may be a sports show, but I sneak in little stuff like this to help the show go along. Thank you both for joining me. I'd love to have you back on for a longer episode, and I truly mean that.
Oh yeah, we're down for that. And remember, this is still sports, because this is a sports marriage. You know, both of us are former basketball players. Don't get it twisted again.
Right.
You know, she's semi pro. You know, I played in the military, but you know, she's semi pro. Okay.
I love it.
But anytime.
Thank you both so much for coming on. We got a break. I will talk to y'all in a deuce.
You're tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
So I've had some very guilty pleasures during coronavirus pandemic. Can't even talk this morning. And one of them just happens to be a show that I got hooked on watching while at work. His name is Rod Peterson, and he joins me right now. And I said, I told him, I got to have you on the show. And he said, yeah, let's go for it. So he's here. Rod, how are you, man?
This is wild. How you doing, Brian?
Your show has become such a guilty pleasure for me from a production standpoint and from a content standpoint because, I don't know, I listened one day while I was on break at work, and I just got hooked. So I had to have you on.
How'd you find it?
Facebook.
Well, that's good. That's good. I'll take it. Whatever it is.
I found it via Facebook, and I was sitting in the break room at work, and I said, what show is this? And I put my headset in, or I put my earbuds in, and I was just stuck there for a good 20 minutes, the length of my break. And I said, okay, I have to mark this. He has to come on the show, and I got to find a way to get him on the show. But you have a fabulous show, my friend. Thanks again for coming on.
I really appreciate it, man. I've been doing this business a long time. The way that we're doing it now is new, as you mentioned, using Facebook Live and the various other, you know, platforms that we have. But I know this, you know, I worked for 20 years in the Canadian Football League, and I never, ever, ever turned down an interview with an opportunity to talk about stuff like this. I appreciate the opportunity, my man, and glad to be on in Indiana.
Oh, man. Thanks for coming on. How'd you get hooked up with the CFL? And my backup question is, who's your CFL team?
Well, how did I get hooked up? Boy, we don't have enough time, but I was the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, which I call Canada's team,
right?
Which I actually tabbed Canada's team. I grew up on a farm 30 miles south of the city, Regina, Saskatchewan, and through a winding road of broadcasting and sport, ended up as the voice of the Rough Riders in 1999. Been just a wonderful ride. And then after my 20th season, pulled the pin, and I actually work full-time in recovery, mental health and substance abuse prevention, addiction, and had some guys come to me, some tech guys, that said, listen, we have this concept for a Facebook Live show, but we thought could move the needle. Would you consider coming in and just, you know, hosting this show on Facebook Live? And I said, yeah. There's a few conditions. They met him, and away we go. And we're sitting here talking about it, Brian. Your listeners probably haven't seen it, so I'm kind of calling it a combination of David Letterman meets SportsCenter meets The View. And I, when you said that you got hooked on it, that's the thing. It's just, it continues. We've done, I think, 211 episodes. It just blows people's minds.
Yeah.
Because there's never been anything like it before.
It really hasn't. I got started doing this. I've been doing play-by-play. I'll start my 25th year in August, covering a lot of high school athletics. I got started doing my show on a dare back in Chicago because a friend of mine heard me do an interview with a local show, and she looked at me and said, why don't you have your own show? I said, are you kidding me? I barely have enough equipment to work with. And she says, okay, find a way to get it live on the program, even if they just hear your voice, and do it. So it took about a month for me to put this together. And when I started in October of 2013, this was an hour-long show, and now it's morphed into a three-hour monster. And I've been inconsistent with it, I will admit, and I have admitted this on the air. But now, since I met my wife and she heard my show, she says, I think I have a few ways of you getting consistent with it and making it better so you don't burn yourself out. I tell you what, man, she gave me some great suggestions, and they're all working.
you got yourself a great woman there.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, so do I, but these guys, these business partners of mine, it's hilarious, Brian, you say that, because it sounds like we could be kindred souls. But when these guys said, come host this show, I said, here's the deal. I want to sit in the chair and talk, and then when it's over, I want to leave. You guys can line up the guests. You guys do the social media. You guys do the sales. You guys do everything. And I just want to sit there and talk and then leave. I'll handle the being entertaining part. But the thing is, when I said I was the voice of the CFL team, I did a daily talk show every day where I did all those things. And it just absolutely burnt me out. It wore me into the ground. And it actually kind of zapped my love for broadcasting. And then probably a couple weeks into this show, the Rod Peterson show, I had guys calling me. Now, again, we're using Canadian terms here, so I'm hopeful that your listeners can, you know, understand what I'm saying. But I had people from national broadcast networks calling me or texting me or DMing me saying, I'm so jealous of you. You're having so much fun. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm like, you're in downtown Toronto on CBC, man.
Right.
You've got the dream. I'm like, you are a national, you know, television broadcaster on TSN, which is our ESPN.
Yes.
And I'm like, and you're calling me to say you're jealous of me? Get bent, man.
Do you know, I can share so many times of people telling me what station I should be on, what station I should be working for, what station and this is my favorite because I got it from my mom for many years, what station I need to be working for. And every one of those times I said I would, but there would be some conditions that they won't meet. And I said this to my mother, and she says, what are you talking about? You're talking sports. Yeah, here's the problem. I will not be allowed to give my unfiltered opinion.
Yeah, that's why I left.
I said...
It took me some time, Brian, to understand why these national broadcasters were saying they were jealous of me. You could see how I would be a little insulted at first, right?
Yeah. Yes.
And then because like you're having fun and you're saying what you want, and so I've had a lot of people in the industry I've been going on podcasts similar to yours, and they're like, Rod, what do you think of the state of the broadcast industry? And I'm like, am I allowed to say that I think it's a toilet? And here's why. here's a great example. We're live, right? With the coronavirus, I'm almost afraid to say this on my show, but I'll say it on yours. TSN and Sportsnet, which are our national broadcasters, like your ESPN, Fox. All they did from like the day the NBA walked off the floor and then the NHL followed suit the next day, these two networks just closed up their doors, boarded up the windows and started running old games or carrying 24/7 American programming.
Yep.
And so a lot of my friends just were sent home and a lot have had their wages docked and they're upset. Because we got into the business to be on the air.
Right.
And I said, why did these decisions get made to run these old games? Because I don't like that. I love the unpredictability of sports. And if I'm going to watch a rebroadcast, why?
Exactly.
There's no point. I know who wins.
Yep.
And these guys, they said the accounting department is running our network. Doesn't that make sense to you when they say that?
it makes total sense. This is why I started my own network, and I've teamed up with a few others that have the same vision. And it's going to become a conglomerate that, for lack of a better term, is going to piss a lot of people off. Because look, people tell me you shouldn't be breaking the rules. Well, if I don't break them, I bend the hell out of them. Doing this online, I bend them like crazy. And whenever I say that, and my wife hears me say that, she just starts cracking up laughing because she knows how I am. But it's the truth. I mean,
give me an example of a rule.
Okay. I've been told so many times that I'll give you a play-by-play example. I cover a lot of high school games, and I have been told by rule that no one will listen to them. You have to give them a video product. So when I was in Michigan City, Indiana, and I had Marquette Catholic under my belt, I said, oh, really? No one will listen, huh? Like, nope, that's the sacred rule, especially in Indiana. You have to give them a video product. So when I hooked up with Marquette Catholic, I said, I'm going to test this theory, and I'm going to make a lot of people mad. The first broadcast I did for Marquette Catholic in November 2013 got me 2,500 listeners.
Wow. Yeah, but see, that doesn't surprise me either. And in the year that I've been, since I left that play-by-play job on radio, mainstream media, I've learned a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
And 98% of them is people don't know stuff.
Right.
People don't know bunk, and they're going to tell you that they do, but
yep.
they don't. And and I like having the freedom to do exactly what you just did. And now, I always say the difference between America and Canada in terms of broadcast or economy or whatever, population is at a zero.
Mm-hmm.
So with our show, it fluctuates, right? You don't have the same amount of viewers every day. But I sit there and, you know, one day we got 10,000 viewers, the next day we got 2,500 viewers.
Yep.
But that's pretty good by Canadian standards. And mm-hmm. if you were to extrapolate that to America, that would be 100,000 viewers.
Yes.
All of a sudden, people are picking up and paying attention. But because we are in, I don't know, are you a Netflix fan, Brian?
Kind of, sort of.
Well, there was the documentary Last Chance U
mm-hmm.
about the college football program in Independence, Kansas. Just to give you an idea where what we're like here, we're like Independence, Kansas. It lives for football. That's it. That's what people get out of bed for.
Beautiful.
On a daily basis is to talk football.
Yes.
But we also, hockey's big here too.
Yep.
So I just knew that if I went on the air and just told stories and brought on my friends from the football and hockey world, we're going to have a winner. And I think the other thing too is people think because it's on the internet, you're going to start being a Howard Stern and
right.
swearing and dropping all these F-bombs.
Right.
And I'm like, no, I'm very respectful of the broadcast industry. I
mm-hmm.
couldn't bring myself to swear on the air.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean I can't still be me and say the truth. And
exactly.
it's just, I think we have reached the tipping point in society where people want the truth. They don't want, I see it all the time on Twitter and stuff. People are ripping the networks, Brian, saying you're lying to me.
Right.
You actually believe what you're saying. And I feel sorry for the broadcasters because I've been in that role.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you know what you want to say, but you know what you're told to say. And they're two different things.
Oh, yeah.
And it was enough for me.
Yeah, that's why I never got to ESPN. That's why I never got to Fox, and I never got to CBS Sports. And I say two words, thank God.
Good. Well, I am now. But the thing is, a lot of those guys sitting at that desk in the nice suit are my friends.
Mm-hmm.
So I try to just tone that down. I'm like, good for you guys. But I couldn't do it, you know, and it took me a while to kind of reconcile it. But again, you know, I don't know how much of a hockey fan you are, but there's a pretty big name in the NHL named Matthew Barnaby.
Yep.
He was a fighter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you might remember him. And just over the past probably 6 months, we've got to be really good friends. And he does his own show on satellite radio. And I said to him, Barney, why are you not on TSN or ESPN, man? You look great. You have everything you need.
Mm-hmm.
You got the experience. And he goes, I just couldn't do it. He goes, I have a studio set up in my house. I'm on satellite radio and NHL radio on XM Sirius, and I don't have to leave my house. I do 2 hours a day, and I'm happy.
And that's the big thing.
I hugged him. Yeah. I almost broke his spine.
Yeah.
I hugged him so much.
I love it. I love it, and it's something I'm building toward. Also, you know, when I get to take the show on the road, and people hear, you know, cars behind me, and I'm, you know, rolling in the trailer, and like, wait a minute, how are you doing this? And you got people rolling by you. Look, I'm happy. I've been happy with Snowman in the Morning for the almost 7 season it's been active. I'm going to celebrate my 25th season in broadcasting. My company's going to celebrate its 25th year. And what people, and I close with this, what people love to throw at me is, you know, I haven't brought in that much money. And I add 3 dots and a simple 3-letter word, yet. It's taken me a while to learn everything that I need to learn. But I'm going to have fun, man, while I'm continuing to build this. And I finally got some people that will help build it with me. I got a couple of other networks that syndicate my show. Now, like you, I got to find some people that want to, that are going, not want to, but are going to really sell this thing. And by Labor Day weekend, I'm going to reach back out to you and say, you really want to have some fun?
Well, I'm going to tell you something. If you really want to get down to it, and I'm not pressed for time here, you just tell me to shut up when you want me to go. But just with the pandemic and coronavirus, as far as the broadcast industry, when you consider, and again, I don't really know what's going on in America. I see the broadcasters are all broadcasting from home.
Yep.
At least they're on the air.
Mm-hmm.
But I think when this lifts, whenever that is, you're going to see a major shift in how the media operates.
Oh, yeah.
And, yeah, you know, and that's I don't know why this is happening. I don't know how it's going to end. But I just know with us, if you're broadcasting with 2,500 listeners to a high school game, you got something to sell.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And it's the same thing with us. I mean, I started a blog, Brian, in 2006, rodpeterson.com. The only reason I started it was to get stuff off my chest. Because when you're calling a game, as you know, when you're calling a game, there's no room for that.
No.
You're calling the game. You don't really have time to get stuff off your chest. So way back then, everybody had a blog. Everybody had a blog.
Mm-hmm.
And they died within a year. And I just see now, 15 years later, everybody's got a podcast.
Yep.
Everybody's going live on Instagram. Mm-hmm. Everybody's live streaming. Well, you know what? They're either going to get bored of that because of lack of listeners. They're going to go, why am I doing this?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to stop.
Yeah.
And the strongest will survive.
Absolutely. It will.
And I would suggest that'll be your show. I pray that it'll be my show. And it's like you say, the sales. I'm not a business guy. Okay. So to go in and ask your business for your money, I can't do it. You know, but there are people that don't have a problem doing that.
Yeah.
So you just kind of got to surround yourselves with the right people. And I go back to the tech side of my show. I have no idea how they're doing it. I've got broadcasters all over the continent, Brian, writing me on Facebook going, how are you doing this? And I'm like, I don't know.
I totally understand that, because last year when I was living in Terre Haute, Indiana, I kept asking myself, how am I going to do a show? Because my wife was at work. I said, how am I going to do a show while she's teaching class? And I had access to the internet, so I figured I'm going to go for it and try to do a show from this little student cafe. And it worked. People were tuning in. They were listening. They were commenting. And I'm going, wait a second. This was all off an idea. I think I'm on to something. And I've been, you know, running with it from there. And now, man, this is too much fun to me. I'm not giving this up. This is absolutely too much fun.
That's the whole idea. And to be honest with you, you don't have to be a hippie tree hugger to say, to actually believe that in 2020, happiness is the new currency. Happiness
it is
the new success.
And I should tell you that one thing that we've realized if you've watched our show is the interactive nature of it.
Yes.
I mean, to be able to watch a show and then to comment with the host is mind-blowing. It's mind-blowing. So furthermore, I mean, just imagine watching Letterman interview or Letterman and Paul Schaefer, and you want to, you know, send in a comment and they address
right.
you. You know, that's what we're doing.
That's the most gratifying and the most satisfying thing about it is when we are interactive, because a couple times I snuck away, I said, let me see what Rod's doing. And I would send you a quick comment and I'd look at my watch and go, oh, damn, I got to go back to work. But it's a wonderful show. Folks, if you haven't checked it out on Facebook Live, just look up the Rod Peterson Show. You will be entertained as I am. So trust me when I tell you that. And the man in charge, Rod Peterson, here on the program, I cannot thank you enough for coming on, and I'd love to have you on again.
Will you do me the favor of coming on my show? That would be the greatest honor of them all.
You
right
got
now.
It. You got it. You absolutely got it. It would be an honor, sir.
Okay, my man. Well, I appreciate the time.
All right. Thank you very much. I got more stuff for y'all when you get back.
Tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
So I was talking with a buddy of mine, and he said, I have a guest for you that I know you'd love. I said, really? Who is it? Well, he put the Ohio State University inaugural in Texas team same sentence. He wore number 28 for said Buckeyes, and he was one of the first to play under Coach Jim Tressel when they went into the Big House, and I know I'm talking to a Buckeye, and I know not to say that school's name, and they beat them. Look, I'm from Chicago, so I know the rules of the Big Ten Conference, the number 10, not T-E-N. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome former Ohio State Buckeye and one of the first draft picks at the Houston Texans from 2002, Mr. Jonathan Wells. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing great, man. Appreciate you for having me on the show, buddy.
I appreciate you coming on to the show. And as you and I are both Big Ten folks, we have a common denominator. Even though you played at Ohio State, the team I support is Northwestern, we have a very common denominator. That school up north gets no love from us.
None at all. we definitely agree there.
There's something about that school up north that drives me absolutely. I don't like them as a fan or as a journalist. If I'm called making it into the big house, that's different. But as far as liking them, no, can't do it.
They're all right, man. They, like I said, I kind of grew into this this love hate situation with them, because you know, you got to remember, I'm not from Ohio originally. So actually, when I was in high school, my mentor Chris Howard, who was a national championship running back there,
right.
You know, that was we played at the same high school. So I had a lot of love for the school. I never thought about going there, but I didn't hate them like everybody else who grew up in Ohio did. Now, once I stepped foot on campus, it was immediate. It didn't take me long to understand that we don't rock with those guys, period.
I used to live in Columbus, and I was warned. My friend told me, no matter how long you live there, you will grow a hatred for that school up north. And I've moved around all over the place, and I'm going, nah, that can't happen that fast. It happened that fast.
Yeah, it's instantaneous. Now, there's still a few traitors that live within the state of Ohio, you know, especially around that Toledo area where we know what's going on with that. But there's still a few haters, man, in Columbus. And I'm like, I don't understand. Like, what would make you just go against the grain like this? I just don't get it.
The year they won it all, 2002, I had so many friends there. And the weeks kept going by, and folks were waiting for the other shoe to drop. Of course, everyone in Buckeye Nation remembers Holy Buckeye from 2002, the miracle win at Purdue. You stopped that school up north 14-9 to close the season. And I remember Brett Musburger's famous call where he said, "Let's party, Columbus." I cannot tell you how much I was pulling for Ohio State to win it all, because I've never seen them do it. But then,
right, exactly,
the overtime, the double overtime happened in Tempe, Arizona, and C. Grant made the final play that sealed that national championship for Coach Jim Tressel and company, and it was a party after that.
Listen, let me tell you, I was at that game. I was on the sidelines. And when I tell you that I was so exhausted after the game, I felt like I had played two games that night.
Yes.
I mean, I can remember vividly. Me, Eddie George, Raymond Harris, we're all on the sideline, kneeling, arms crossed for that last play. And when we got that sack and that ball went in the air,
yep,
we lost our everlasting minds, man. What a great memory. Yeah, what a great memory. I mean, I was a rookie in the league, so you got to remember, I had already fed all of the guys on my team that went to the team up north. Actually, after we beat the team up north, I came into the team meeting that night, and I had a big old bag of Tostitos chips. And they was like, "Man, you're doing too much." They're like, "You're doing too much, Jay Weezy. Come on, man, knock it off."
Oh, wild? This is what got me to be a Northwestern fan was when they beat Notre Dame in 1995.
Okay.
That got me being a Northwestern fan, because they were a 28-point underdog, and they beat Notre Dame at Notre Dame Stadium 17-15. And then Penn State came up later in the season, school up north came later in the season, and I had a bet with a friend of mine. This is one of the few times I did not root for Ohio State, and it was very personal. I had a friend of mine who said to me, "Ohio State is going into the big house, and they're going to beat that school up north, and we're going to win the Big Ten title, so I feel so sorry for you Wildcats." I said, "Oh, yeah, I'm willing to bet you that doesn't happen. And immediately my brain is going, what the hell are you thinking?
Well, guess what? You were right on point, Mike. Listen, I wasn't even at the school. I was still a sophomore in high school.
Right.
And I was sick with Timbi Akamatuka, went out there and went crazy. I was like, are you kidding me? 300 plus your
300 plus. Look, I couldn't even pronounce Timbi Akamatuka correctly, and I've tried for years, okay? It's got people to this day saying, who the hell is Timbi Akamatuka? And what's he up to?
He left his mark. He is forever a legend. And he was going against Eddie George that day. And he thought, oh my goodness, I was sick. I was sick.
That year, 1995, there were three great running backs in that conference. And they were intertwined all season. Bi Akamatuka being one, Eddie George being the second, and the third, who was the rushing leader for Northwestern, Darnell Autry. So people were asking, though they knew who Eddie George was. That was obvious.
Mm-hmm.
They were asking, who the hell is Timbi Akamatuka? And for that matter, who the hell is this Darnell Autry kid?
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, that was a great season. They had a great year that year, for sure.
Yeah. It was a wonderful, wonderful season. Talking with Jonathan Wells, a graduate of the Ohio State University, you got to take me through that national championship game, watching those players coming back against Miami, getting basically a second chance in overtime. They get the tying touchdown, and they had to move back 5 yards due to a penalty for the extra point. And when it went through the window, you just heard the entire state of Arizona just exhale. 77,000 plus. Most of that, they just exhaled when that extra point went through to force the second overtime.
Yeah. I mean, to be honest with you, man, it was exciting. I was a part of Jim Tressel's first year at Ohio State.
Right.
So to see how far that we came in only 2 years, from my senior year, was his first year. So, you know, when we went 7-5, you know, we lost, mm-hmm. we lost three games where we had 17-0 lead against Wisconsin. They came back and beat us. We were up 27-9 versus Penn State in the second half. They came back and beat us. We lost a lot of close games, that senior year. But those losses were what actually fueled those guys the next year, because they learned how to win those close games. And that's the difference between my senior year and that next year. Mike Doss and Will Smith, rest in peace, and, you know, Craig Krenzel stepped in, did a phenomenal job. Maurice Corrett came in. So these guys, they understood, you know, what it took to win those close games, because we had lost so many of them the year before.
Yeah.
So that's how we got over the hump. So for us to get to the national championship and be playing against, you know, what was arguably one of the best teams ever to play in college football in the history of the game, one of my childhood friends, Ed Reed, we played playground ball together, you know, so to be across the sideline looking at them, and, you know, they had about 100 former players. We was deep on the Ohio State sideline. I mean, it was absolutely intense in there.
I bet it was.
Yeah, that whole situation, man, to come out on top and actually, you know, win the first championship in, what, 38, 39 years, and actually be there and be a part of it. I mean, man, you can't even draw that up any better. Later on, Coach Tressel wrote me a letter and said, you know, that my leadership, you know, in the year before is actually what led to that championship. And I tell you, I hold that letter from Jim Tressel near and dear to my heart, because I worked hard my senior year. You know, I put the I put the boots on the ground. I bought all the way into the Coach Tressel way, and I tried to lead those guys as best as I could. So I know that I left a good DNA in there, and those boys took it the next year and went all the way to the top. So I'm extremely happy about that.
I loved Tressel's speech when he was introduced at the Schottenstein Center.
Yeah, the basketball game. Yeah, oh yeah.
All he had to say was, and in 310 days from now, and he didn't even have to finish his sentence, and the whole place went nuts.
Yeah, in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Oh, yeah, he said it. Yeah, he said the word.
He
might have just said Ann Arbor.
Where but Ann Arbor?
That's an epic speech that'll go down in history for sure.
Man, it will, and so will that team, and so will Trestle. Jonathan Wells joining me here. Now let's take me through the process of when and how you got drafted to be a part of the inaugural team in Houston when the Houston Texans were born. Take me through that.
Oh man, I have so many feelings about just my whole draft process, some of the decisions that I made, and as I sit back and look on it now, you know, just even my decision to go back home and train to get ready for the draft was one of the worst decisions that I ever made in my life. I should have never went back home to New Orleans. You know, I was my agent had just, you know, given me $100,000. I never had no money before in my life. And I just really, I wasn't even really focused like I needed to be going into getting drafted. I'll keep it all the way real looking back on it.
Right.
But nevertheless, you know, I ended up going 99th overall to a new franchise. To be honest with you, I was pissed. I was mad. I thought that I should have got drafted a lot higher after coming off, you know, 1,300 plus yards. In the Big Ten, basically facing 8 or 9 in the box because we had no passing game that year whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt like I was, you know, one of the top 3 to 5 backs in the country and ended up going 99th overall. So I was a little disappointed. My draft day was terrible. I had a draft party at my house, didn't get drafted. You know, back then, you know, it was only 2 days.
Yes.
You know, so I had the media, I had all my family, all people from the neighborhood come to the house. And I didn't get drafted. So you can only imagine that I was distraught after that. So
yeah.
I ended up being the very first pick of the next day. The 99th was the first pick of the next day. So I didn't have to wait long, you know, which was a blessing. But I was mad, man. You know, so I went to Houston with a chip on my shoulder. Now, what I can say is Houston was a state-of-the-art first-class organization. Rest in peace to Bob McNair. I mean, Everything about Houston was phenomenal. I have no quarrels with the organization, the facilities. Just everything was first class, you know what I mean? So now, you know, as I look back on it, do I wish I maybe would have got drafted to a more established franchise where I could have, you know, went in and learned maybe? Probably so. But, you know, to go in there, I ended up starting, 10 games my rookie year,
mm-hmm.
Leading the team in rushing, so being first leading rusher in franchise history. And, you know, I had a phenomenal time in the city of Houston, man. The city of Houston was great. Oh, my goodness. We had a ball. They showed us so much love in Houston. So, overall, man, it was cool. You know, but as I look back on it, I could have been a lot more focused. And I could have, you know, just did some things better. But, you know, neither here nor there.
Yeah.
You know, that's how it worked out.
Yeah, yeah. If you could change one thing that would have made the process better, what would be that thing and why?
Like I said, I would have went somewhere where I was way too comfortable at home, you know, trying to get ready for the draft. I would have definitely, what happened was we actually lost our strength coach, Coach Dave Kennedy at Ohio State. He ended up leaving the year Trestle came.
Yeah.
So normally all of our guys, we stay there, we work out with Coach K, but we ended up calling Coach K. He was at the University of Nebraska. I forgot where he went. But he was like, man, you know, I'm kind of like, you know, trying to do some new things, man. You know, y'all going to have to figure it out. So he didn't allow us to train with him. So my next move was, okay, I'm going to go home and I'm going to train with Tom Shaw, which is a phenomenal strength coach.
Mm-hmm.
So if I would even took that serious, I would have did a lot better in my pro day as well. But that would have been my only thing, man. I just would have went somewhere where I didn't know anybody. I would have went somewhere where I could have just focused 100% on training. And I went to New Orleans, man, and got into partying and just doing a whole bunch of other stuff that had nothing to do with getting ready for the draft.
Yeah, Jonathan Wells joining me here, the man, a part of the Ohio State University under Coach Jim Tressel. One more point, and you got to take me through this. Being a part of the Big Ten, knowing you had to go into the Big House and being labeled as the team that broke the curse, Take me through that week and take me through that Saturday.
Well, I got to go back a little bit before that. Now, you know, mind you, when I came in 98, we smashed them. Like
yes.
David Boston, Joe Germain, Mike Wiley. I mean, we embarrassed them in the horseshoe.
Yeah.
So for me, like I said, I wasn't from there, so I never had this "we can't beat them" mentality. I didn't care about it. I thought they sucked from day one.
Right.
So as I moved into my sophomore year, I ended up having what, 3 carries for 90 yards in the Big House.
Mm-hmm.
So my second carry was a 76-yard run, one of the prettiest spin moves you ever see. But I ended up not scoring. I got caught on the 5-yard line. The guy tripped me on the 5.
Yep.
I didn't score, and we ended up not getting any points. Now, mind this, Tom Brady was the quarterback. We missed the field goal. Tom Brady was the quarterback. We were up by 7 before I made that run. If I score, we go up by 14.
Right.
And I think we win that. And I think we win that game. I don't score. We go 3 and out. Missed the field goal. Tom Brady comes back and he beats us by 7. Okay? So
the legend of Tom Brady begins.
I held this within myself for the next 2 years. I could not wait to get back up there and finish what I started. So skipping to my senior year, we went back up there. Like I said, we were 7-4 or 6-4 going into the game. And you know, we had lost a lot of close games. Now, mind you, the week before, my quarterback gets suspended for a DUI, so he's not going to play. My starter, he doesn't play in the game, Steve Belisori. So that's how Craig Krenzel ends up getting his first start up there. So I basically just told Tress, man, listen, put it on me, because I was in the zone at this point. Like I had like 7 back-to-back 100-yard games. Like I'm ready now. Like I'm at the top of my game. It's, everything is finally lined up for me in my college.
Right.
I'm like, coach, man, give it to me. Put it on me. Don't trip. I got you. He's like, all right, J-Dub, let's go. So he comes out. The defense is just crazy. I gotta give a shout out to my defense that day, 2001. Will Smith, Darren Scott, who else was on that defense? Mike Doss. Matt Wilhelm, Derek Ross. Those boys played lights out football out there that game. So I got to give a shout out to my defense first and foremost. But offensively, man, we pretty much ran 2 and 3 tight ends. Like student body right, student body left.
Yep.
We're not passing. This is what it is. It's J-Dub versus y'all. Man, Coach Stressman. Now, mind you, I never got the ball more than 22 times a game in college.
Right.
He comes out and gives it to me 25 times in the first half.
Yep.
I got 129 yards going into halftime. I got 3 touchdowns on the board already.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, in my mind, I'm like, oh, I'm about to pull a Tim Biakuma joker on these boys. I'm about to kill them in here today. Bro, my first carry of the second half, I get the carry, 7-yard squirt. Now, mind you, I could have popped that one. My calf just gives out on me. I'm like, what? And I grab my legs. I'm like, are you kidding me? Dude, I started trying to stand up. My second calf cramps up. They had to come get me off the field. My hamstring starts cramping. My stomach. Dude, I got full body cramps. I had 1 carry in the second half of that game. I went to the locker room and had to get IV for the rest of the game, pretty much.
Gosh.
I didn't make it back out of the locker room until about 3-4 minutes left in the game. So that game is still a bittersweet moment for me, because we were up 23-0 at halftime because I had 3 touchdowns in the first half.
Right.
But I didn't play in the second half. That's what a lot of people don't understand. I played 1 play in the second half. That's it. And I was in the locker room getting IVs. So that is still a bittersweet moment for me, and I thank God we were able to hold them off and beat them 26-20, because if they had come back and beat us, I wouldn't have been able to live with that, bro.
Right.
So, you know, that day, as special as it was, and the 3 touchdowns in the first half, oh, that's cool. But, man, I was going for over 250 yards on them people that day. Like, they could not tackle me that day, period.
They couldn't.
And my body gave out on me, bro. So, you know, that's I still hate it. I still hate it till this day.
I still hate it. I totally understand. A little bit of insight to Big Ten football, not just from a journalist perspective, but from a player's perspective. Jonathan Wells, one of the inaugural draft picks of the Houston Texans and a prior graduate of the Ohio State University. And you better believe I plan to have this man on a lot more to talk some more football and to talk some more life lessons. Man, this was fantastic. Thanks for coming on, my friend. I look forward to having you on again.
Okay, man. I appreciate it, man. Thank you.
That'll do it for this edition of the Daily BS. I want to thank you all for listening. Thank you to my wonderful guests. And I want to thank you, the wonderful fans that have tuned in the region, across the nation, and around the world. Want to sponsor this here program? Drop an email to snowmandigitalmedia@gmail.com. That's snowmandigitalmedia@gmail.com. And also, you can find us on snowmandigitalmedia.com for a great replay of this show. And don't forget, the podcast version thereof is available immediately after I get the heck out of here, which I'm about to do right now. Have a great afternoon. God bless. Remember to make your next move your best move. And always remember, if your dreams don't scare you, then they are not big enough. Dream big, do bigger. I am, and I hope you all are too. Until tomorrow, when I'm back at you again with another edition of the Daily BS, I'm signing off until 22 hours from now. So long, everybody.